quiet revolution seems to be taking place in India. For decades, the government ruled over the country at their own discretion, not very different from the kings of yore, and the citizens quietly accepted what was meted out to them, occasionally complaining, but never really protesting strongly or trying to make a difference. However, 50 years down the road, there was a felt need to speak out, for people to make themselves heard, for governments to know what it was that they were doing right and where they were going wrong. It was time that governments were told that schools needed teachers, that hospitals needed doctors, that roads needed maintenance and repairs, that water supply needs to be continuous rather than sporadic, and that officials need to be courteous to citizens. Citizen groups across the country opted for different methods to make themselves heard. One such effort, which was pioneered by Dr. Samuel Paul of Public Affairs Centre, Bangalore, was the Citizen Report Card.
In simple terms, a report card is a grade that citizens give to a government or its agencies based on their perspective. By aggregating the data and analyzing them, interpreting the findings, we are able to indicate how a government has performed or how a public agency has delivered its services.
The first report card was done in 1994 for the city of Bangalore, a major city in southern India, which is the information technology hub of the country. The city's infrastructure and basic services, which were provided by the state, certainly left a lot to be desired, but unfortunately, with no options for the citizens. Citizen report cards have played a big role in improving standards over the years. Two additional report cards were carried out in 1999 and in 2003. The fact that three report cards were done for the same city certainly helped in benchmarking the services as well as the satisfaction levels. This has not only helped the citizen groups but even the government to compare their own performance as well as to compare services across a time span of almost a decade.
Here, apart from our organization, we had feedback about other utilities also. Yeah. That was good in a way, to compare ourselves with others also.
A quiet revolution had begun in government circles. The citizens' voice was being heard and there was a concerted attempt to address the issues raised in the report cards.
In a very organized manner, in a very scientific manner, getting the inputs from the people, getting the feedback from the people, and then making use of those kinds of feedback in policy making, decision making. My first experience with PAC occupies a prime position.
A public-private partnership forum was soon set up in Bangalore by the Chief Minister of the state to assist the service providers to upgrade their service and responsiveness. It was the first time ever that a chief minister had launched an initiative to improve services in response to citizen feedback. Several initiatives were started to improve service quality. One such was the improvement in billing procedures in some of the agencies.
We used technology right to the hilt. We had the Kaveri Com kiosks, we had the online complaint management system, we had the web page, we had the interactive voice response system in 1916. Then we had periodic meetings with residents' welfare associations. We used to go to them.
The expectations of the people also increase. So there's a constant competition within the organization. And then a lot of training we had undertaken to educate our own people. We have to perform. There's no other way out.
The revolution slowly made its way in government circles outside of Bangalore too. In Mumbai, India's commercial capital, a report card done by the local citizen group Praja effectively became the impetus to set up an entire online system for monitoring citizen complaints within the local government. The Maharashtra government too realized the power of report cards and is now using it to monitor services in the rural areas.
And the credit goes to the state government. It's not that we take any credit for that, because the governments understood the need for the reforms in the first phase. So that there is some ownership within the governments about these whole things.
In yet another case, the marginalized section of the society living in the slums of Mumbai, along with a local NGO called Apnalia, did the survey themselves. As a result of the community ownership of the study, the citizens drew up a manifesto of the changes that they sought and gave it to the local election candidates. The tables had turned. Instead of the candidates making election promises, the citizens had provided the candidates with a list of their demands.
खास इस वार्ड के जो भी मांगे स्पेसिफिक मांगे हैं, उस मांगों को हमने कुछ कैप्चर किया। तो मुंबई शहर का तो चार्टर बना था, वो तो बहुत बड़ा था। उसमें से कुछ मुद्दे निकाल के हमने फोकस करके पांच-छह मुद्दे निकाले थे, जिसको हमने फोकस में लाया और इस मांगे का एक अलग चार्टर हमने बनाया वार्ड के लिए। मकसद यही था कि इलेक्शन आ रहा है, इलेक्शन के समय पे कौन सा उम्मीदवार अच्छा है, कौन सा उम्मीदवार हमारे लिए काम करेगा, कौन सा उम्मीदवार हमारे मांगे सुनेगा और उसकी गारंटी हमको देगा, उसी को ही हम वोट देंगे।
How is a citizen report card carried out?
We make an assessment of the conditions in the locality to see if they are conducive to carrying out a citizen report card or not. Some of the factors, for example, are the political setting in the country, whether it is a democratic or a non-democratic setup. Then we see whether people or the citizens have the freedom to speak out their minds. How active civil society organizations are, or how active NGOs are in that locality, then the leadership orientation of the service providers, whether they are proactive, whether they are receptive to our suggestions or not, and several such criteria that we look at. And once we have looked at these critical factors, we then make a decision as to whether we can carry out a citizen report card and how easy or difficult it is going to be to carry out a citizen report card and strategize upon it.
Who is the report card best done by?
The CRC can be carried out by different actors. It could be either done only by the government, it could either be done by one NGO, like we have carried out several report cards on our own independently, or sometimes we also have an independent consortium that is formed, which is a group of all these different stakeholders coming together and working out things in such a way that they carry out the citizen report card and look at each and every stage of it and make sure that things happen after the survey is carried out.
Can report cards be done only in democracies where there is freedom of speech and expression?
In a non-democratic setting where such individual freedom does not exist for the citizen or for the media, a civil society initiative for a report card may be more difficult. But it does not rule out government itself or a public agency making use of this approach. In fact, this has happened in Vietnam, in China, they are talking about it. So I think we have now evidence that non-democratic settings may also be able to take advantage of this approach.
So the government would like to know how about the opinion of people on public services, how they are satisfied with the public services, and we would like to get their feedback when they using the public services. Based on that one, we would like to improve the public services.
I think this is good news to change government mind, to change the work.
The actual execution of the report card begins with the planning on the areas to be covered the sampling pattern and size, and various other preparatory aspects. A focus group discussion identifies the issues to be covered in the study. This is followed by the designing of the questionnaire, one of the most critical parts of the exercise. The questionnaire is used to carry out the survey amongst the chosen sample. On completion of the fieldwork, the data entry and analysis are done in order to bring out the final report. Dissemination of the report amongst the citizens is an intrinsic part of the report card exercise. The print media was chosen in most cases to disseminate the report card findings among citizens. In Bangalore, the media initially highlighted only the negative findings. However, over time, newspapers have adopted a more participatory role in the process by not only focusing on the different wards of the city, but even organizing interactive meetings with citizens in all areas of the city to highlight their problems.
And two other issues which the report brought in, and that was very useful to us, was that number one, there was shortage of buses. In fact, it changed our entire approach. This, impetus to increase the number, to increase the supply, to tap the latent demand came from this report, saying that, look, a large number of people feel that you can increase the number. There is shortage in supply. And the other thing also it talked about is the concern of some 5%, 6% of the people who were interviewed or the households about the high fares. And from this report, we thought that one way to tackle this issue is to come up with innovative ideas of passes.
Over the last decade, report cards have gone far beyond being just a voice of the citizens. They have worked as a diagnostic tool, as a monitor of corruption, as a tool for sectoral reform, and of course, for benchmarking the quality of services provided.
It emerged as a tool for social accountability and demand mobilization when committed citizens and groups used the rich and credible information provided through report cards to hold the state to account, to nudge agencies to reform, and also to mobilize various stakeholders to bring in that missing component in good governance called demand mobilization.
We are also now asking the government to issue citizen charters, saying that what the government will do, or what will be the standard quality of the services given by the government.
As we moved along, we found that it's a very useful diagnostic tool. When agencies themselves, governments themselves, started using the tool to take a look at how well their structures are in place, how effective the service delivery processes are charted out. So that's the second emergent function that we found.
How report cards could be taken up by governments is illustrated by the recent invitation the Delhi government gave to PSC to design or prepare a report card on Delhi services. Here the initiative has come from the government.
Report cards are excellent tools to look at hidden cost. Things like corruption, things like bribes, which existed in the realm of the abstract, had a number behind it, had a kind of a face behind it. This profiles of vulnerability, as we call it, started to emerge, especially when we look at pro-poor services. This tool became extremely handy to highlight the depth, the spread, and the intensity of corruption, intensity of extortion in services which matters the most to a lot of poor people.
These citizens' reports, therefore, have given me the needed material on the basis of which I can proceed further and attack those departments which are most corrupt among the departments of the government. See, on the basis of this, when I have done it, see, several crores of rupees corruption has come out.
Down the line, report cards started seeping out of the cities. It started looking at sectoral programs, it started looking at food security networks, it went into the health sector, it went into industrial permits and licenses. So in each of the applications, the primary focus of the report card remained unchanged. That's the power of measurement and the power of comparison. we believe in the dictum that what gets measured gets done, what gets compared gets bettered. So this twin objectives of the report card did not undergo any radical change, but what it brought alongside was this broad sweep of the canvas. From merely looking at city level delivery functions and metropolitical issues, it started assuming a national character, it started assuming a sectoral character. Around the year 98, I would say that it started going international. We had demands from donor agencies like the World Bank and the UNDP to look at this as a good practice at that stage.
We have tried to discuss with the government that the government has to use the survey that we have conducted, PANE conducted on CRC, as an input for the second poverty reduction strategy paper, as well as in monitoring and evaluation of forthcoming programs.
So which takes us to the next application of report card, that is benchmarking. Trying to see the extent to which reforms have impacted on various segments of the population. Unfortunately, despite being democracies, we often find that reforms reach only to certain enclaves, which is missed out in the secondary statistics. So if you want to really find the extent to which reforms have impacted and the segments of populations which are being excluded, which are being isolated from the existing reform agenda, this bottom-up evaluation, this credible way of capturing citizens' voices, people's voices, we feel, and it's increasingly being echoed elsewhere.
It was almost like a two-phase process, a huge report card that established benchmarks and just got people interested, and then smaller report cards that actually provided specific policy recommendations in certain sectors.
We don't know when the next survey is coming, so we have to keep ourselves and keep on trying, like maintaining your first rank in the class. Yes, it has been very healthy competition, and it has brought very healthy awareness among our employees. We keep on quoting this in our internal meetings, saying that, look, the survey may take place, so please don't slip away and slip down.
When civil society initiates a citizen report card, funds and skills could be a problem. On the other hand, government may have the funds and the skills, but they may lack the motivation to bring about change. To be credible, it is important to avoid political partisanship. Professionalism and neutrality are critical characteristics for success. Coalition building and dialogue with government are not easy and take time. Patience and willingness to stay on course are important. Finally, the sustainable citizen report cards need champions. This applies equally to government and to civil society initiatives.
The report card continues to evolve in its application, but it always is demanding accountability and a change for the better. The leading newspaper of the country applauded the work done by saying, Public Affairs Center, in creating this forum, has opened doors, even windows, for a healthy tete-a-tete with our service providers. The honesty on display was remarkable. This is the spirit of democracy in action. Civil society working in tandem with government for the greater good of all.